Hi everyone, and welcome to this tutorial bite for Oxygen Not Included, which will run through the ways to make power. This video is on power generation, which is a key part of power systems that will be covered in a dedicated tutorial bite. I'm going to run through how to use each type of generator, including some tips and tricks, so we'll start off with the manual generator. Of course, this is the simplest type and makes 400 watts when a tube runs on it. These can be built right from the start and will be needed to power early research to unlock other generator types. As they only make power when dupes run on them, this becomes time consuming as the colony grows, and there isn't really much more to say about these. So the next type available is the coal generator, and this is typically the point where dupes no longer need to spend time making power, freeing them up for other things. Coal generators produce 600 watts, and obviously need to be supplied with coal, which is commonly dug up around the map. Hatches also produce coal, but require large amounts of minerals to feed them, so it's difficult to make sustainable. Once fueled, they will run continuously, consuming 1 kilogram of coal per second and producing some heat and 20 grams per second of carbon dioxide. I will give the precise heat outputs in the summary, but the exact numbers aren't really useful from a practical perspective. A key point here to counter all of the generator's downsides is the smart battery, and it's an important building for controlling generators. To make smart batteries, you need 200 kilograms of refined metal, usually made early on in the rock crusher, and refined metal is also needed for automation wires as well. Use the recipe for 5 times to make 250 kilograms, which is enough to make a smart battery and wires. Smart batteries send an automation signal to the generator when simply linked by an automation wire. Note that this is additional to the power wire, so both are needed. When the battery charge decreases and hits the low value, it will send a green signal to turn on the generator. Then once the battery charge reaches the high value, it will send a red signal to turn it off. This significantly improves using all types of fuel-consuming generators, and I wouldn't even build a coal or any other type of fuel-consuming generator without this in place. For settings, it is advisable to have a high value less than 100, so around 90 or 95. This is because if set to 100, the generators will finish their animation when the batteries are full and waste small amounts of power. The low value I would initially set to around 20, but this brings me on to another important point about prioritizing types of generator. By using different low values for different generator types, you can choose which to turn on first. In this example, the smart battery's low setting for the coal generators is 20, the hydrogen at 30, and the natural gas at 40. When I turn on these power consumers, the batteries will empty, and when the highest low value is reached, the natural gas generators will turn on first. If this is enough to refill the battery, then this is the only type that will be used. But if not, then the next highest low value will be turned on, and so on until the power draw is met. Note that one smart battery can control multiple generators, or can be used individually. Just ensure every generator is connected to a smart battery. As a tip, the power generation breakdown can be found in the colony report in the top right, and it's usually a good idea to check the last completed cycle. This shows which generator types are making power, as well as the wasted power from generators that ran when batteries were fully charged. Consumers are shown here as well in ascending order, and can give a good idea what to turn off to reduce power consumption. Jumping back over to the generators, the next type is the wood burner, which consumes lumber produced from arbor trees. They are quite inefficient and only produce 300 watts whilst consuming 1.2 kilograms per second of lumber and produce 170 grams per second of carbon dioxide. The power output is only slightly better when using the ethanol distillery to turn lumber into ethanol and then burning it in the petroleum generator. Lumber is obtained from arbor trees, and these can be grown domestically or as wild plants. Note that they are not natively available on all planetoid types. When domesticated, each tree consumes 70 kilograms per cycle of polluted water, so it can be difficult to supply in large numbers. Wild planting is generally preferred, and arbor trees are food for the pips that can plant them, so they work well together. I will cover wild planting in its own tutorial bite. So next up, the petroleum generator consumes 2 kilograms per second of either petroleum or ethanol and generates a large 2 kilowatts of power. The waste outputs are also large, and 750 grams per second of polluted water and 500 grams per second of carbon dioxide are released into the surroundings and will quickly build up. These generators are a powerful tool, but require well-managed fuel production and generator area for the waste products. Ethanol production is done with the ethanol distillery, which consumes lumber. This output can be stored or burnt as required. I explained simple petroleum refining from crude oil in the tutorial bite for plastic and steel, but I'm showing an example setup here too. Crude oil can be found naturally occurring in oil biomes and can also be extracted with oil wells, which will be covered in their own tutorial bite. Using the refinery building loses half the mass of oil when converted to petroleum. The heating oil to just over 400 degrees Celsius to make petroleum keeps all the mass. A design to do this is known as a petroleum boiler, which is an advanced build that will also be covered in a separate tutorial bite. Natural gas generators consume natural gas at 90 grams per second to produce 800 watts of power, 67.5 grams per second of polluted water into the surroundings, and 22.5 grams per second of carbon dioxide as a piped output. As a tip here, ensure the gas output pipes do not run over the other output ports or they will get blocked, so instead join the pipe segments. Natural gas is mainly collected from natural gas vents that can be found on the map, which are sustainable sources of power. Geysers and vents will be covered in detail in their own tutorial bite, but my preference is to simply enclose the vent with a steel pump so it doesn't overheat. Then, the gas can be stored elsewhere, with my preference being for infinite storage. For other sources of natural gas, Lachlan & Dukes will fart out small packets, and oil refineries, fertilizer synthesizers, and oil wells also make natural gas in relatively small but still usable amounts. Another source is from gassy moos, which eat gas grass to produce natural gas, although this is challenging to set up. Finally, natural gas is the output from sour gas boilers, which is an advanced build. Again, these will be explained in their own tutorial bite. Hydrogen generators consume 100 grams per second of hydrogen and produce 800 watts with no waste products except heat. Hydrogen gas is commonly produced by electrolyzers and can be consumed locally or stored for later use. This is a key part of the self-powered oxygen machine, or SPOM, as I explained in the tutorial bite for oxygen. Hydrogen vents are another common source, but temperatures can be an issue. As these produce gas at 500 degrees Celsius, either thermium should be used or active cooling is required. In the Spaced Out DLC, lug slugs are also a source of hydrogen and power when consuming metal ores. Personally, I avoid these as metal ore is limited without space mining, so I prefer to keep this for building with. Next up, solar panels are a clean power source and produce varying amounts of power depending on the light intensity, up to a maximum of 380 watts. They must be set up at the top of the map with exposure to sunlight and then connected into the power grid. It's much easier to set these up in the Spaced Out DLC due to the lack of meteor showers on most planetoids, but beware that light levels also vary between planetoids. In the base game, protection is required to keep solar panels safe, and I will cover this in the tutorial bite on meteor showers. As tips, the base provides solid tiles and can be walked on, and it's also a good idea to provide batteries to ensure no power is wasted during the day. Beware that window tiles block 10% of light, so should not be placed above solar panels, but mesh tiles or ladders can be used. Steam turbines have a dual purpose in the game of power generation and heat deletion, and are more commonly found in cooling applications. They are placed on top of tiles, usually insulated, and draw in up to 2 kg of steam from below, and output this as 95 degrees water through a liquid pipe. To run them mainly for power generation, a heat source is required to input steam at over 125 degrees Celsius, and they produce up to 850 watts of power depending on the steam input temperature and the open ports. With all ports open, the maximum 850 watts is made with steam over 200 degrees. Energy will be wasted if the temperature is higher than this, so blocking off ports reduces the flow rate but increases the temperature for maximum power. Here is the table that shows how the number of ports open affects these key parameters. An important point is that the turbines make significant amounts of heat and need to be actively cooled, usually with an aquatuner loop which can be placed in the steam room. For an explanation of how to set these up, see my tutorial bite for cooling. On the topic of generating steam, the first source to mention is from hot steam vents that produce steam at 500 degrees Celsius. Note that cool steam vents are not hot enough to simply extract power from without additional heating, so to make steam any other way, a source of heat is required, and common sources include volcanoes and rocket exhausts. I will cover these in the tutorial bytes for geothermal energy and rocket tunnels. So having gone through all the generator types, I'm now showing a summary of the key info. In the course of a game, a typical path might be to start with manual and coal generators, then move on to hydrogen generators from a SPOM and natural gas from vents, and then later on solar panels and petroleum generators are good sources to power the colony. The last topic to quickly discuss is the tune-up buff that can be provided by the power control station. This consumes refined metal to make microchips, which applies the tune-up buff that increases power generator output by 50% for 3 cycles, requiring a dupe with the electrical engineering skill. Although this can save fuel, I generally find the time and refined metal required outweighs the benefit. And that wraps up this guide to power generation in Oxygen Not Included. I hope this helps you keep the lights on in your colony, and thanks for watching.